Okay, this is the Unit 4 homework solution. To recap, the first thing I wanted you to do is make a registration page. This should look basically like the homework 2, where we made the form. And so, you know, if you type in some junk, we get the same error messages. And if you type in a valid username and password and you submit, you get redirected to this welcome page that says welcome, and then it has the username in it. And the username this time is not included as a GET parameter. It's actually included in a cookie. And I'm using this little cookie extension in Chrome so I can see the cookies. And in this case, you can see it included. This is supposed to be the user ID 5. This is the hash of that, as we discussed that technique in the lesson. So let's look at the code for this first problem. Once you've solved this first registration part of the homework, the other two parts of the problem are very easy because they just kind of build on the same code. So we're going to be going through a lot of code here for this first part. The first thing I have is I have a secret, which is just this random string that we're going to use as kind of our hash secret for cookies. Normally, I wouldn't store this in the same file as my code. I'd probably store it in some other module that's only on the production machines or something like that. But for our purposes, it's fine just to stick it in here. Again, a lot of this code you've seen before, template directory stuff. Here are two functions. You know, you basically had quiz problems in the lesson for generating these functions, for making a secure val, which takes a val and just returns that value, a pipe, and then the HMAC of that val. We did this in the lesson, so you should be familiar with this. And then a function for taking one of those secure vals and making sure it's valid. You know, we split on the pipe. If we call make secure val on the value we pulled out of the string, if it matches that string itself, it's valid. So you've seen these functions. We did them in quizzes, and we're going to be using them in here. Here's this blog handler. This is the class I've been using, kind of parent class for all of my handlers. I added some more functions. Write, render, stir, and render. Those are old. I've added a function called setSecureCookie, which basically sets a cookie whose name is name and whose value is val. All it does is it basically gets the secure, calls makeSecureVal on this val, and then it stores that in a cookie. And we store a cookie by just using the setCookie header and say name equals val, path equals slash. We could also include an expires time, but I didn't here. So by default, these cookies are going to expire when we close the browser, which is fine for our purposes. And then we have another function for reading a secure cookie. You give it a name, and it finds that cookie in the request if that cookie exists and that cookie passes checkSecureVal, we return cookieVal. In Python, you can use this kind of shortcut notation for saying it's the equivalent of writing if cookieVal and checkSecureVal return cookieVal. If one of these is false, we just return false or none or whatever. We've got this function login. This will be used for the second part of the homework for actually doing logins, and this just sets the cookie. And we've got a function logout, which I believe is the third homework question. We'll come back to these. I added this function initialize. You don't strictly need this. Google App Engine is a function that gets called before every request. And so what I have it do is check for the user cookie, which was called user ID. If it exists, store in self.user the actual user object, which we'll get to this in a second. Now, you don't have to do this, but kind of did the more complicated route where you have to log in to enter things into the blog, and it keeps track of on all the blog pages who the user is and that sort of thing. So if you're going to have that kind of structure where once you're logged in, every page is a little bit different, it's handy to have some sort of function like this that gets run on every request and just checks to see if the user is logged in or not. And that's what this initialize function does. And this function is called by the App Engine framework. So we still have some of our, you know, some of the blog stuff. I've been doing all of the homeworks in the same file, so you'll see some of the other homeworks in here. We have this function makeSalt. This was a quiz function, just to make a string of 5 letters. So that's what this does. This makes our salt. This function was also a quiz function, I believe, for making a password hash. You know, it takes a username and a password and an optional parameter for salt, and then returns the salt, comma, the hashed version of the name, password, and salt. This is what we store in the database. And then we have this other function, also a quiz question from the lecture, of how to verify a password. So it takes a name and a password and the value in the database, and it makes sure that the hash from the database matches the new hash created based on what the user entered in. Again, quiz question, you've seen that before. User's key, this creates the kind of the ancestor element in the database to store all of our users. Again, you don't have to do this. You know, I like to have things a little bit organized. So again, I gave it kind of a parameter and thinking maybe I'll have user groups in the future. I don't right now. That's just how I did it. Okay, so now we get to some interesting code. This is our user object that we'll be storing in the database. So it inherits from DB model. That's what makes it a data store object. And it has 3 parameters. It has a name, which is a string property required, a password hash, which is a string property also required, and an email, which is a string property, but not required. Now remember, we don't actually store passwords in our database. We just store a hash of the password. We can't grade that. We can't tell how you're storing the stuff in your database. Well, we could, but we'd have to, you know, have you, I don't know, write some other handlers or something. So, but this is how I'm doing it. And then I added a couple functions on this class object. I'm sorry, on this class that are kind of convenience functions. The syntax here at class method, this is called a decorator. I'm not going to get into exactly what decorators are, but what at class method does is it says you can call this method on this object. It doesn't have to be an instance of this object. So normally you would say the first parameter on a method on a class is self. That's kind of referring to yourself, that instance. In this case, I call it CLS for class, which means it's referring to this class user, not an actual instance of the user, you know, not spez, not an actual user object. So we can just say user.byID, give it an ID, and then we'll call this getByID function to load the user out of the database. GetByID is built in the data store. If you recall from the previous homework, I had this kind of make key thing and just called the get function. Well, that was before I learned about this getByID function, which is a more convenient way of doing what we were doing there. I have another function called byName, which looks up a user by its name. I'm using the data store procedural code again for doing the database lookup instead of the GQL, because I prefer typing this. I think it's a little bit easier to read. And all you do is you say filter name equals, and then you can give it another parameter. So this basically says select star from user where name equals name. We call get on that, which returns the first instance, and we return that. Another function I've added, this method called register, which takes a name, a password, and email, and it creates a new user object. So the first thing it does is it creates a password hash for that name and password, and then it creates a user object. The parent is that user key, not required for you guys. Name equals name, password hash equals password hash, email equals email. So that creates the user. It doesn't actually store it in the database yet. It just creates the object. And here's another one called login. We'll come back to this one, but it's fairly self-explanatory for the future homework. So now let's go down to the handlers. You can see I've added three handlers for each of these three homework problems. The first one we're talking about is signup. So slash signup goes to the register handler. Let's take a look at that. Now the register handler here inherits from the class signup. Signup is actually up here, and it's identical to what I had, or nearly identical to what I had for the homework too. Since I'm working in the same file, I didn't want to rewrite this whole class again. You know, we're still rendering signup form like we were before. I'm not going to go through this in great detail, but you know, we still get all the values out of the request. We still check to see if they're all valid. And if there's an error, we re-render the form with the error messages and the values, you know, just like we did before. And if there's not an error, I call self.done, which in this class signup doesn't do anything. It just raises an error. And then I have two other classes that inherit from signup and overwrite this function done. The first one is the unit 2 signup page. And all that one does is it redirects to slash unit 2 welcome with the get parameter. So that's how we did the unit 2 homework. The register one overwrites done to have different behavior. First, what it does, there's an extra error that can occur in this one is that the user can already exist. So what I do is I look up to see, does that username already exist? And if it does, set an error message, and I re-render that form, error username equals message. So I probably could have done this a little bit cleaner, but this is kind of just tacks on an extra message. So this it doesn't appear that it preserves the parameters if you enter in a duplicate username. It's a little less than ideal. I probably could have put some more things in there, but that's how we have it set up here. Otherwise, if that error doesn't exist, we register the user, which creates our user object, and then we actually store it in the database here. And then what I do is I call my login function. All the login function does is set the cookie. So for the first homework, you may not have a login function. You may actually just set the cookie here, and then we redirect to the welcome page. But then I generalized it when I did the login version and just made this work, have this login function that, you know, multiple handlers can use, because we'll have both the signup page for registering and signing in, and then we'll have the login page for, you know, not creating a new user but signing into an old one. And they can both use this login function. And we'll go over that in a second. We redirect to unit 3 welcome, which is down here, this handler unit 3 welcome. And all this does is it checks to see if self.user, and remember, self.user gets set up in that initialize function. That's where it reads the cookie and makes sure the cookie is valid and sets the user on the handler. And since this unit 3 welcome inherits from blog handler, it has access to that user. We render our welcome HTML. You can probably guess what's in there, with username equals self.user.name. Otherwise, we redirect to the signup page. See that working one more time again, so now that you've seen the code. Okay, so if we enter in a username and a password, we should actually get an error message that this username already exists. And we do, and it cleared the form because I was a little bit lazy on this one and didn't preserve all those parameters, although I easily could have. So let's type in a new username and submit the form. Everything worked. And if I were to, on this page, modify this cookie. Let's change it to user ID 5, which is what we had before. And I were to reload this page, we get redirected to the signup page because the value in that cookie doesn't match the hash in that cookie, so therefore it's invalid, and we get bounced to the signup page. So that is the first question in this homework.